Welcome to our presentation titled Overcome Mobile Testing Challenges, featuring John Jeremiah of Hewlett Packard. I'm your host, Francesca Mattu. Before we begin, I'd like to explain how to participate in today's event. This presentation contains streaming video and content, so to optimize your bandwidth, please be sure to close any unnecessary applications that may be running in the background. Now, you'll notice a widgets toolbar at the bottom of your console. Click on the appropriate widget to view the speaker bio and presentation abstract. Click on the handout widget to download the speaker's presentation to your virtual briefcase. And if you're loving this presentation, go ahead and tweet about it through our Twitter feed. By clicking on the Twitter widget. Also, please send us your feedback about the presentation via our short four-question survey. To submit a question, use the moderated chat panel. Technical questions will be answered within the chat, and we'll try to get to each of your questions to our speaker during the Q&A portion after his presentation. And now, at this point, I would like to turn things over to John Jeremiah on the floor at STAREAST.
Good morning, everyone. This is a great morning. I'm excited to be here with you. Can you hear me okay? Good? So I'm John Jeremiah. I'm with Hewlett Packard. I'm part of our product marketing team. And I'm real excited to be here with you today to share with you a little bit about our thoughts about mobile testing and how to overcome the challenges associated with mobile. And it's not just about mobile testing. Testing is one part of it. I'm going to want to talk a little bit about end-to-end mobile and the challenges associated with managing mobile, the whole life cycle, and a whole life cycle approach. As we get started, one of the things I want to do, a little housekeeping. Most people ask you to turn off your phones and to silence them. I'd like to be a little different on this one. Turn on your phones. Go ahead and turn up the volume. If you feel the need to interact or send text messages, you feel free to text me. No, I'm really quite serious. Please text me. I'm going to interact with you a little bit later on as we go, and so if you don't text me, then I'm going to have to text myself. And that was fun in rehearsal, but it's more fun to text you in the audience now. So the mobile world is constantly changing. It's happening all around us. And I'd like to start with, rather than spending a whole lot of time on stats, I want to show a movie. So can we show the brief movie that I put together? And what we're going to show is, a few short weeks ago, I spent some time in the lovely city of Barcelona with 65,000 of my closest friends who were all gathered to look at and talk about the mobile industry and to look at it. And it was amazing, the energy and the passion and what's happening as far as how mobile is transforming all around us. And I grabbed a few pictures, and I want to show that here because I think this is really informative, and it was an exciting time. So Mobile World Congress is this annual gathering. It's one of the largest mobile conventions in the world. And a subset of it is applications, all focused on developers who are developing and building applications. We had an exciting presence there talking about everything from printing to device management to testing. It was amazing. Now, the other thing at the show that was also impressive was, when we think about mobile devices, a lot of you are carrying iPhones and Apple and iOS devices. They don't go to this show. This is everything else. Android was huge at this show. BlackBerry was there. Windows was there. It occupies several city blocks and takes over this whole section of the city all around mobile. This is what you can get when you do mobile statues using phones as the art form. Unbelievable. We saw 3D phones that you can look at 3D phones and have real 3D images looking at the device, no glasses. Samsung had amazing devices. They were able to drawing beautiful artwork on these tablets with styluses. Of course, styluses aren't supposed to be back, but this is the use of stylus today. And as we looked at this, we saw innovation around phones such as this phone, which innovates in a way that's really creative. You can take the phone and put it into your tablet and it becomes your tablet. And then you can also have it sitting in a docking station, so your phone, your tablet, and your laptop are all one. Now, they even thought about what do you do when you get a phone call? Because it's kind of awkward to hold your laptop to your head. So what do? They have a stylus, a Bluetooth stylus, a pen, and you answer your pen. I can imagine answering the wrong pen if I had the device. But mobile is huge. It's happening all around us. And the growth of mobile and the number of devices that are coming out and that are announced is really invigorating. And it means that all of us have to wrestle with this. How do we test? How do we help our businesses ensure and deliver mobile solutions that are going to be reliable and are going to serve the needs of our users? You know, then there's near-field communication, beaming information from one application to another from a phone. This capability opens a whole range of innovative and interesting things. Imagine holding your phone up to the door in your hotel room and it opens the door for you, because the phone knows who you are and the door knows who you are because your phone is there. Get rid of those little plastic things and your phone then becomes your key. Your phone could start your car for you with that kind of technology. It's just a fascinating industry, and it's an industry that's only happening. It's happening faster and faster, and it's getting more complicated. Check it out. Microsoft Office on a phone. So Windows Mobile and Windows Phone is also going to enter the market, and it's going to become even more complicated and more challenging as we go forward. So let's go ahead and go forward. We'll go back to the slides, and we'll continue on. Please feel free to text me as we go through the demo. I would love to have some interactivity, so I haven't seen anyone texting yet. So hopefully some of you have your phone out and you're going to text. But mobile is happening all around us. And if you look on the web and you look around you, the evidence is obvious, right? The evidence is clear that people are using mobile devices in ways that are different, innovative, all around. And here's a few more numbers just before I close on it. These numbers are not the Powerball numbers for next week. These numbers represent the number of different Android phones, tablets, and OS updates in the last 5 years. And I haven't even, and don't even add Windows to it. Don't add the carriers. Don't add that to it. Mobile is happening. It's vibrant. It's going on all around us. And if you want to know the stats for it, I did a little research to pull this stuff together. And it's just amazing how fast things are moving. And mobile's changed, right? Do we all remember when we got our first phone, our first device, that we could thumb out messages? The first time you got a BlackBerry and you could send text, you could do email, that was so cool. But that's changed, right? Now it's not about sending text and email. Now it's about interacting with business processes. It's about interacting and engaging with your customers in ways that are new and innovative. It's about business processes and business transactions. It's not just about collaboration and being a little more efficient at processing your email inbox, which, if you're like me, mine is going to overflow by the time I get done. And mobile, the capabilities that I showed in the video, mobile is different. I mean, I can't do near-field communication and location and photography with my laptop, but I can with my phone. How many of you can process a check, can submit a check to your bank with a camera on your phone? It's common. It's almost table stakes that if you're a bank, you should have an app to allow your consumers now to put a check into the bank. You don't have to go to the bank or the ATM anymore. Think about what this means to insurance companies. How auto insurance companies can now change the way they process claims and change the way they interact with their consumers because of the capabilities in mobile devices. These are creating business opportunities. It's not just about neat technologies. It's about innovation in the way businesses interact and serve their customers. And so as we go through this, it's going to create change and pressure on the business to innovate. The first bank that introduced the optical check, the image check capability, they were the leaders. They had that. What happened at their competitors? Imagine the conversations that were happening in the competition, who all of a sudden realized that now they have to catch up, and they don't have a lot of time to catch up. Imagine the phone call to the VP of apps, the portfolio management team, that says all of a sudden, guess what? We have to build a mobile app that does this because they're doing it. Businesses now are forced to reinvent and think about how can they be innovative around this technology and how can they leverage mobile devices to connect not only with their customers, but with a whole new set of customers. Around the world, mobile devices are becoming the primary way a whole segment of the population connects to the internet. The mobile phone, the tablet, is the way that a lot of people are accessing the internet, and the only way. And so business has to respond and has to come up with ways to best serve them. And this then creates pressure and challenges on who? IT, right? Because when the business wants it yesterday, who has to deliver it tomorrow? IT. And the way we've done things in the past, the pace of change, the rigor, the pace of delivery, often won't meet the needs of mobile, to deliver at the speed of mobile. So I think of several challenges that IT organizations struggle with. And I want to just talk through a couple of those, and then we'll go into a little deeper level. The first real challenge, I think, is around alignment. Now, in your organizations, I just want to see a show of hands, how many people have an organization where you've got more than enough time to get the work done, the list of projects is manageable, you don't have any problems? Show of hands. And I'm going to look, show of hands in the virtual world, no one's raising their hands, right? No one at all is acknowledging the fact that you have enough time. All of you are struggling with the fact that you have limited resources and an insatiable demand for innovation and projects and changes to applications. Guess what? Mobile is going to multiply that. Everything is going to be about mobile. And it's going to cause for real challenges as to how do you align the organization and the infrastructure and the decision making in order to account for the value of mobile and to prioritize it against all the other different possible initiatives. You also have to think about how do you ensure that the organizations that support the application and the ones that deliver the application are also equally aligned. I'll talk a little bit about monitoring later as to how you do that. But the key is that if you're not doing it, there's a huge risk. You have to have alignment around the organization. It's even more important in mobile. Now, I'm from HP, Mercury, so testing is a part of this. It's an incredibly important part of it. You know, testing of a mobile device, functional testing, you can always roll it out and test in production, right? Just deploy it to production and let the users find the bugs. That's an option, right? It's always an option, right? Test it, let it go in production, let the users find it. Some issues with that, some minor problems that might come up. For one, we'll talk about social media. Has anybody tweeted today? Any tweeters? Nobody? Well, people who use mobile phones sometimes tweet. Do you want them to tweet about your app? Do you want them to go on Facebook and talk about how crummy your app is? There's a major media provider that I uninstalled their app because it was so bad. And then I looked at their star rating. It's horrible. Were they doing functional testing of the app to make sure it would work on my iPad? No. And the great big bar of one-star ratings illustrated why. Do they have quality? What do I think of their brand? You know, functional testing, the challenges are, how do you adequately test the application on the devices that matter, the platforms that matter, in a way that allows you to be fast and responsive and to give the business a sense of coverage that you're confident that we can deploy this app and it's going to work and it's going to serve their needs. And this can be a real challenge. We approach this, and I'll talk about our approach to functional testing a little bit further into the conversation, but this is a part that can be very difficult. A lot of companies, functional testing, when I talk to them, if I took a picture of functional testing, it looks like this. And when they want to simulate bad network conditions, they go to the elevator. Yeah? I see heads nodding. I mean, it's the way a lot of people are wrestling with this. They load the app. Everybody kind of brings their phones to work. They have their phones. They load the app, and they see what happens. It's not very repeatable. It doesn't give you good coverage. It's hard to say this is exactly what happened. Very hard to get screenshots and to really capture the what it took to cause and to recreate the defect. All of those become challenges later on when you try to then recreate and test and correct those defects. Performance is also another area where it's different in mobile. It's just a little bit different. Not only from the perspective of you, the user on the phone, because you're dependent upon this mobile infrastructure, this shared network, right? You go to a conference, this is probably not a conference where we have enough people to crush the cell system, but I've been at them before where all of a sudden the cellular system crumbles because so many people are trying to access it, taking pictures, sharing video, they're doing things on the cell system that all of a sudden it doesn't work. It worked yesterday, but it doesn't work today. And the network has a huge impact on this. Now, when we look at mobile, the system that's supporting these mobile users sees a much different traffic pattern than it does with traditional web with traditional traffic. The transactions are slower, they're more lethargic, and it can have a real impact on system performance. And so having a way to ensure and to evaluate mobile performance before you go to production is a pretty important thing to do, because otherwise you're likely to show up on that Facebook page because you hadn't accounted for performance, and you also run the real risk of impacting existing systems as well. So we'll talk about performance as well. I think it's a challenge that people wrestle with mobile, and it's one that there's a variety of approaches to it. A lot of it, regretfully, sometimes is hope and pray. You know, it's a methodology that sometimes organizations use, and it's a gamble as to whether it's going to work or not. But performance is a key element. Anybody worried about security? Anybody worry about security? Is mobile a security problem? Anybody lose a phone? Anybody ever lose a phone? Yep, I see heads nodding. I mean, industry statistics show that people are losing phones very frequently. They're stolen. You think about the data that's on the phone. You think about the information that's there, the access that's on that phone, the secure passwords that aren't there. Think about the data that's being sent back and forth from the systems that's being exposed in the transmission from the device. Think about the web servers that are supporting these mobile applications and the security concerns there. We have a great track record for building security into all of our applications. And so naturally it's gonna go to mobile as well. And I'm being a little sarcastic, but we've got to address security. We've got to look at how do you improve the security of the whole mobile platform and ensure that the applications are secure and provide the right level of security to meet the risks associated with the organization. Very important topic to consider in mobile delivery. And then the last challenge really is, it gets into how do you avoid your solution to monitoring? How do you avoid your first warning that you have a problem with your app being how many stars you're getting in the App Store? How do you make it so that you know and that you're monitoring and able to evaluate the performance of your application in real time without relying on end users giving you negative feedback? I mean, testing in production is perhaps one strategy that says, well, we'll just let the users test it and tell us if it's not working. That's the way a lot of times these are monitored as well. But having an approach that allows for monitoring and a solution to really gather feedback and to gather performance and insight before you read about it in Facebook is also a key consideration and a key challenge that we have to address with mobile. One more plug, ruthless plug for my phone. So feel free to text me. I'd love to interact with you, and if you don't, I'll have to ask someone in the audience for their phone number, so you can self-nominate. But let's look at some of the solutions in the end-to-end perspective. And I've probably highlighted this and hinted at what I think it is. You know, it starts with having an approach to portfolio governance and management of the portfolio to build alignment in the organization around the strategy as to what's important. It then leads into being able to have a complete end-to-end view of the application delivery lifecycle, having the ability to manage from requirements to testing, the end-to-end view to have visibility and to ensure that the right things are being developed and that you're able to manage the process and deliver things on time in a predictable way. You also have to have security as a core element of it. It can't be an afterthought. Too often security shows up late in the life cycle, and it's too late to fix security afterwards. Look at how many patches we have to get to operating systems others because security was overlooked in the design and build. And so then we'll talk about functional testing. It has to flow all the way through. Performance is a key element. And then lastly, monitoring. We've got to think about this whole cycle as to how do we accelerate the cycle? How do we cover the issues along the way? And what are the tools and processes we're going to use in order to be effective and efficient at delivering mobile solutions? Testing is a key part of it. We'll spend some time on that in a second. But I want to step through each of these kind of briefly. Almost every large organization struggles with identifying and prioritizing which projects, which initiatives they should pursue. How do we measure the business value? How do we know which ones are the biggest priorities? Often it's the person with the loudest voice who stands up in front of the meeting and stomps in and slams their hand on the table and says, we're going to do my project. That's usually the person sometimes that wins in organizations that don't have good governance and good processes around how to do this. And so this is a challenge of who's available to work on the project, how do the projects align with strategy. This exists today. This is a traditional problem. And mobile only multiplies it, right? Mobile only makes it more difficult to understand which devices are we going to support? Which applications are we going to roll out first? Which users are we going to address? And which needs how are we going to connect with them? You know, eventually it all will go to mobile, or almost all will. But the path from here to there, and how do we integrate all of these new demands for mobile devices and mobile capabilities? How do we bring that in then to our portfolio and make decisions? How do we build the skill sets? Because most companies are at their infancy in building the skill sets around mobile. There might be a small team dedicated, there might be a few people who are dedicated to it, but the broader capabilities around mobile aren't there yet. You know, this is similar if you go back into time in the early days of the web, of when all of a sudden everybody needed a web page and nobody knew how to get a web page. If you think about the early days of when the internet took off, this is a similar kind of transformation in which all of a sudden a new technology is disrupting the way we work and the way we interact. So having an approach to solve for governance, to gather and capture demand, to track and manage that, things like our PPM solution and our executive scorecard solution help to give executives insight into the performance of the organization, the performance of projects, to be able to have insight into the fact that a project is off track. These are the kind of tools that need to be in place to do this, and there have to be the processes and the rigor to support it. Executives have to have the ability to influence change. And one thing that I know about executives is they don't have the ability to see the future. They don't have superhuman vision to somehow see through the fog and know that there's a problem. We have to give them the data and the insight to do that. And these kind of solutions help to do that, help to present that information so they can take action and fix projects that are troubled or stop them if they should be stopped. So that way we can proceed. Now, this is a picture of requirements to code, requirements to testing, with the traditional walls that exist between the BAs and the developers and between everyone else and the testers. And the testers are often left at the end wondering, well, what do we have to build our test cases to? They don't know what the developers are doing, right? A lot of times they struggle to have insight into the whole life cycle. And it's the over-the-wall mentality of build it. Nobody really does it quite like that, but these problems exist in lots of organizations. Requirements are developed, then they're ignored. Then they're not necessarily developed to meet those requirements, and we have a conflict at the end as to exactly what's going to happen. We really have to break the walls down and provide visibility from requirements to testing. Fast iteration, teams working closely together. We could do an agile presentation on this topic. It really is agile operating at a very high degree of refinement. And you have to have the ability to see the end-to-end life cycle. Right? It has to be the team is enabled to work collaboratively together across geographies, across regions, to track and manage mobile requirements from beginning to end, and then to incorporate the mobile testing to test the right things and to test the things that have changed. You know, it's often really difficult for testers to understand or to look at a release and to understand what's changed in this release. You know, they have some insight, but they really won't know for sure. They won't have a high degree of confidence to know what's changed and what they have to test. Now, our approach to this is one that I actually get pretty excited about when I look at it. It's really around understanding the lifecycle intelligence and insight into the whole world. Now, ALM is our management tool that manages the whole lifecycle from requirements through testing. And what we've added with this application lifecycle intelligence capability is the ability to pull the developers into the process seamlessly, to give the developers the ability to interact on in their IDE, and to give us true end-to-end traceability to the code. So imagine a tester now in the world that I'm describing. The tester is getting ready to test a release. They're able to look at coverage and look at what requirements have been covered in the code and what code has been introduced that have no requirements. What defects have been fixed and in what part of the code. To have true understanding of what's happening in the code at the build level in the exact modules. And all of that comes from the developer's work in their IDE. No longer do we ask the developer to come to ALM to log in and do the work in the ALM platform, but we're able to now have true end-to-end traceability, which then lets the developers optimize and prioritize their work to be efficient and effective in order to deliver faster testing results and more reliable testing results. Security is also going into the security dimension. People are worried about security on lots of different levels, from privacy, data security, viruses. There are a whole host of threats that occur in the wild in the mobile space. And we have to have a way to solve for that, right? The solution around security has to be systematic. It has to be end-to-end. It has to start early in the life cycle. There has to be a clear understanding of what's expected from a requirements perspective for security. And that has to be built into the process with reviews and evaluation of how secure is the application. It's a different way of thinking about projects and security, and it's not something that it's just the problem of information security. It's something that the whole project team has to embrace as they go through that solution. Now, to help this, we have Fortify as the ability to manage requirements and to manage and to look at code from a static analysis perspective and also dynamically looking at the solution from a security perspective to help people improve the security of their applications. Incredibly important across the spectrum. And the key around mobile that I think is most interesting, and it was an eye-opener for me a while ago, was when I started to look at mobile security. I thought mobile security really was all about what happened on my phone. I thought that if I lost my phone, that this was mobile security. I had to fix my phone, right? This is the problem. And the learning that I had was profound, was it's not necessarily this is the problem, it's part of it. But the larger problem is the whole infrastructure of servers and things that are built to interact with this phone. Those have to be where you look at from a security perspective to make sure that the web servers and the infrastructure is secure in addition to this. It's the number of vulnerabilities that you create in your infrastructure to support the phone is really one of the areas that often is overlooked. And it was a moment which I thought about and I realized that the real vulnerability is my access to my core systems. A phone is just one point. And there are great solutions around device management that can help wipe the device and deal with theft, et cetera. But we really have to look at the whole end-to-end nature of the system and how do you manage and drive security. So testing. I think there's three parts to testing that we need to think about from going faster. First off is coverage. How do we have coverage? Sufficient coverage around testing in order to guarantee or ensure that the application will work as deployed. do we have sufficient number of platforms that we're going to test against, the right variety of platforms of different devices, different operating systems, different patches, different carriers, and do we have the ability to reuse test scripts? Do we have the ability to reuse a test script to make sure that our functionality is consistent across multiple devices? In addition to that, we have to think about performance. We have to bring together the idea that performance is not just generating a bunch of synthetic load against the system. Anybody can do that. But you have to include the characteristics and the conditions of the mobile network. If your performance testing only does 100 or 1,000 or 10,000 users, it's not complete. It's going to give you very false results. You'll have a false sense of confidence if you don't have a way to bring into account the kind of variable, bad to good network conditions that your users will experience. And then lastly, velocity. You know, how do we accelerate delivery, which really relies on automation and being able to do automation on real devices from a testing perspective to develop scripts and pick up the pace and quickly develop and deliver automated results that give us confidence about the build of our application and our application quality. That becomes also a key element. I think these are the three big areas around mobile testing we've got to worry about addressing, and how do we drive that? And so, In the spirit of solution, what we've chosen to do, and hopefully you've heard of Quick Test Professional, WinRunner, you know, we have a long legacy, a long history in supporting automated testing on a whole variety of platforms. And so the WinRunner and the QTP platform, part of unified functional testing, is a very, you know, has all the power and capability of automating testing. It integrates with ALM, does lots of things. We've worked with partners to develop extensions to QTP, and the one I'm highlighting today is one I think that's really interesting because we're able to now connect with a lot of different real devices, and we're able to drive automated testing on real devices, which is one of the things we're going to do in a minute in a live demo, which is dangerous. I like danger. So real devices in the cloud eliminates the need for me to build a test lab where I have to have a file drawer or a file cabinet full of dozens or more phones that I have to manage all of these phones' service plans, that I have to worry about where these phones are going and who's using them for other things, the long distance bill that shows up on my phones. You know, as a former leader of a testing organization in my past roles, I don't want to have to manage that. If I don't have to, I don't want to be in the business of managing a drawer full of phones. And because these devices are available in a cloud, I just connect to them and use them. It becomes quite easy. And so whether or not I have a public cloud access and I'm sharing the devices with everyone else, which is very cool if you're into sharing, or if I'm concerned about the privacy of my data and protecting the devices and having them in a private cloud, both solutions are available. So whether I want a very secure infrastructure, a very secure cloud of my own phones, or I want to share phones, whichever approach will work, allows me then to use QTP to drive these tests and to run it. So now I'm going to go ahead and shift into the part of the presentation that I consider to be most dangerous. And if you'll bear with me, we're going to see what happens. So what I have up right now is I'm in QTP, and I'm connected to a mobile device. And this device, I believe, is in Boston. And this is part of Perfecto's mobile cloud. This is their plugin in QTP. cool. 33 people have texted me. Testers rule. Who's 917? 917? Who said testers rule? Yeah. 304? Who's 304? Someone in the audience? No? Well, I need someone in the audience for this to be effective. Can I have a phone number? Say again? Nine oh four, nine zero four, seven zero five, 8956. Thank you. And what I'm going to go ahead and do then is I'm going to go ahead and run a test. And hopefully your phone is turned on with the volume up, so we'll hear it ring. And I'm going to ask QTP to go through and I'll be honest, this is somewhat of a trivial test, but I'm trying to demonstrate really the fact that what we have here now is a real phone really interacting with. Hopefully I get the right phone number in, otherwise someone's going to get some strange text messages.
Oh.
And so QTP is now running through the test, driving the phone. And the first thing we'll do is we'll go ahead and we'll make a phone call. And the perfecto solution is recognizing the images on the phone, just like you or I would, right? We see the images, we go, oh, click on that. And that's exactly what we're doing here with this test. And so somewhere the phone is ringing. And we'll hang up on them because I really don't want to talk to them. QTP does not carry up a very good conversation on the phone. I've tried this myself, and it doesn't leave good voicemail messages either. But then in lieu of that, we'll go ahead and we'll send a text to this person. And interact with them. So what I'm able to illustrate here, really simply, is imagine what would this be like? What would it be like if I had an application I needed to install on the phone? And if I had an application I installed on the phone, ran through my automated functional testing, and then uninstalled the application and let go of the phone? I could very quickly get the results. Because these devices are sitting in a cradle with a camera looking down on them, I'm also able to play back that test and see what happened on the screen. You know, this solution allows me then to see the device while it's being tested, to play back the movie of what just happened. So the solution to the challenges of getting screenshots, of understanding what happened if I have a failure, if I have issues, all of that comes into the play and helps me with this solution. Also, I can develop, I can also equally develop scripts that are generic and agnostic enough that I can run the same test on multiple devices. The test we did in Barcelona ran through an iPhone, sending a print job from a phone in Boston to a printer in Barcelona. And then when that test completed, we went back and we ran the test cycled to another phone, an Android phone, and the same test went through on an Android phone. So I'm able to have one test, multiple devices, as well. So I don't have to build all these different test scripts. I can build test scripts that are generic enough that I can be agnostic to the device, which is also a very powerful capability from a functional testing perspective. Now I can spin up a bunch of test cases and test multiple phones fairly fast in a sequential way. Yes, sir. Yeah, microphone would be better.
I'm sorry.
I'm trying to understand how you would go transition from one device to another successfully, because the home keys are oftentimes in different places. The way you bring up the application can be different. The initial, you know, so just between iOS and Android, there's a significant difference there.
Yep.
If you could help us understand that, that'd be helpful.
Absolutely. I mean, first off, there's a dose of magic, a little bit of magic, because it's just software. But the reality is what happens is the script is developed to be aware of what kind of device it's on so that it can behave differently in different parts of the script. So it's not that such that the script is 100% agnostic. There's perhaps 20% of the script, I can show you the one I used in Barcelona, where it actually says, if I'm on this device or this type of device, I do it this way. Otherwise, I do it another way. So it's a case of accounting for that when you develop the script. Right? But the rest of it, assuming your application is more or less the same, then, and because we're looking at just the images, right? If it looks the same, then I click on the thing that looks like this, and there it is. Yes, ma'am. Yeah. So when I wrote the script, what I did is I said, here's what the phone icon looks like, and I told it. And so QTP has an object which references an image of that phone. Yeah, it's in the object repository. It's not the object on the phone. It's the image of the object on the phone. It's the image of the phone. So it's a little different. I mean, there are other ways of solving this problem, right? The other way to solve the problem is to instrument my code and then to expose the actual objects at a lower level of object recognition that just QTP does anyway, that QTP does in a lot of ways. But because we're on the phone, it's recognizing the images on the phone, and that's how it's driving it. And if you have really, the folks from Perfecto Mobile are here as well. They're at the show. They have a booth. They can take you much deeper into the actually how they've done it, what they've done. I'll stay at a fairly high level. Any other questions? We have a question from the web.
From the virtual audience, really quickly, I'm trying to find it. We got a lot of questions and a lot of comments coming through. Do you have BPT support for this?
I'm sorry, can you say that one more time?
Sure. Hold on, let me find that question again. Sorry. Do you have BPT support for this?
Yes.
Add-in?
Business process testing? Just as if, you know, with QTP integrates with BPT, we have the ability to do business process testing as well. And we'll have some time, I think, for questions. I'm watching my pace, and I've gone a little faster, which is natural, than you do in rehearsing. I should have run these a little longer, but we'll have some time for more questions at the end. So I talked about mobile performance, right? This was a demonstration we did last year where we had a little load test, 500 virtual users hitting a system, right? Really cool. Sub-second response time, we're rocking. About 10 minutes into the test, we said, let's introduce 50 mobile users. Let's add some mobile users to the system. We figured, all right, that'll be fun. We'll have less than 10% mobile users and see how the system performs. We abandoned the test after 9 virtual users, mobile users were added. Because what happened was the servers were dealing with these long delayed connections, server resources were consumed, and all of a sudden the whole system slowed down. And we went from sub-second response time to 5 or 6 second response time. And it was obvious what was going to happen next. So we stopped. But this is an example to illustrate the fact that mobile is different. Mobile can introduce a new dimension to systems that really require an approach to performance testing, an approach to evaluating the performance of the whole system, of a whole mobile system. Now, with Load Runner and Performance Center, we've had a long track record of having the ability to develop and generate synthetic load on systems and to evaluate and understand the performance of those systems and where there are bottlenecks and where there are problems within a system in order to optimize the performance of those systems. And we're used around the world by large corporations. We've developed mobile protocols for both web application, mobile web, and for mobile native applications. We have a protocol for each that support developing synthetic load as if it's coming from mobile phones. We can take a mobile application and capture the transactions coming out of it in the case of a native application, or in the case of a mobile web application, we can use True Client to quickly script and develop transactions for mobile web. with Shunra's integration. Shunra's a partner of ours who for many years has had this capability built into LoadRunner and Performance Center. Shunra for HP, the solution allows you to then dial up or dial down the network conditions based on each load generator. So you can easily have a test scenario that has multiple load generators, each one of which, one simulating a 2G, one simulating a 3G, another one maybe on Wi-Fi, all of which giving you a realistic then representation of what our mobile user is going to do to the system. This is really what represents complete performance testing of an application. And it's a solution, I think, that you have to account for both pieces. Now, these things work together. So why wouldn't we work, put them both together in a way that's interesting? And the way that's really interesting would be to have a load on the system with LoadRunner or Performance Center, causing the mobile system to experience transactions so it's operating under load as if it's under stress. But then to also incorporate automated functional testing with the GUI protocol, and LoadRunner then can drive a real mobile test, a real device. So that way we can now evaluate and understand how does it perform from an end user's perspective while the whole system is under load, giving the testing team the ability now to look at the whole system from a real device while the system is under load, so we have a complete view of performance and functionality of the system. Just a couple of more slides, and then we'll have more time for questions. Then we talked about performance and monitoring and understanding what's happening to the system in production. We try to do this today with all of our corporate system. A lot of our systems, we try to monitor and evaluate and detect outages and problems users are having before they call the help desk. Well, there's no reason we can't do the same thing with mobile. And with mobile, we have a greater dimension, a greater number of problems. Is it the carrier? Is it the device? Is it the app? A lot of different things can cause those kind of problems. And we have to be able to then look at the whole infrastructure and understand where that's at. And a lot of it comes from the ability that we have within application performance management and business service management tools to take and reuse our scripts to then generate the same sort of synthetic transactions to evaluate the performance of the system, just as we do with load. We can do the same in production. We can take the same approach and monitor and evaluate the system and then gather and understand when we're seeing problems with the system and then be responsive to that before our customers find the need to update their Facebook status or to give us one-star ratings as they're uninstalling the application. And sort of in closing, the way I think of this, we really have to have, and regardless of the tools you use, I mean, I've highlighted some of the things that we're doing at HP, which is sort of natural, but regardless of the specific tools you choose to use, you really have to think about the whole life cycle of mobile and how do you accelerate and align the teams around delivery? How do you get it so that these teams are able to operate at the speed of mobile? You're able to remove and eliminate bottlenecks and problems and get them to delivering faster to meet the needs of the business. That, I think, is where you have to have a complete solution, a complete perspective. And it's not necessarily a tool thing. It really is about organizational alignment, and it's about making decisions. And it's about then choosing the right tools for the situation or integrating the tools you have to solve for that. And that's where I think the key really is putting that together. I'm pretty excited with what we're helping people do and how we're doing it. And I would love to share more of that with you. I've got a little more time to answer some questions. We have a couple of different references. If you're into this QR thing, you can use your mobile phone and scan those, or you can click on the links. Either one will work. But you can go ahead and access these pages. Or my contact info is up also. I'd love to have the conversation with you. On the expo floor, Perfecto Mobile is demonstrating their product, and you can exercise your aviation skills with Perfecto Mobile's helicopter challenge, which is always a highlight in these, to see people fly helicopters in the shows. Just reach out to Or you can come by our booth and we'd love to talk to you as well about that. Are there questions? Do I have some questions I can field? Are there virtual questions?
Yes, I have a lot. So let me just quickly go through a couple of them. Does this solution capture objects and builds and object repositories with real objects?
No. The way the solution approaches it is from a visual, from recognizing the objects, the visual objects, and the object repository then is a reference to what that looks like. So it's in a way, I think of it as being the way I interact with, you know, my phone, and I operate my phone. I'm recognizing objects. I'm looking for what's on the screen, and I'm reacting to it. I think it's a very similar way. Is that a fair way to describe it?
Okay. What is the protocol in LoadRunner used to test mobile, used to test mobile testing, especially native apps?
So we have mobile true client for web apps, and we also have the mobile applications protocol. Both of those are presently, they're part of our Web 2.0 bundle, which is where we make them available, and they're both available there, and we'll probably have more updates on those in the future as well as we continue to evolve.
Okay, I have a couple more.
Sure.
Okay. Do you also have the possibility to monitor mobile application performance? How much is FPS or some animations and applications? So that I would see in test summary screen lowest FPS numbers, for example. Sorry, it's kind of worded.
SPS. I'm not sure. I'm not sure if I know if I understand that question.
Sure, we'll move on to another one, and hopefully I might get some clarification. So, how do you connect with QTP to actual devices? Is this what Perfecto does? Can you have it on a local network?
Yeah, so the QTP, how you connect to QTP to devices, to real devices, there's really a couple of ways. The Perfecto solution is based upon putting these devices in the cloud and making them available, and there's three different ways that they're made available. The first way is to make them available in a public cloud, a shared cloud, where they manage a data center of devices around the world. And these devices then you can connect to, check out a device, run your test, and you're done with it. The downside to that or the issue that people wrestle with is, well, they're shared, right? I have no idea who was sitting in the seat before me. I have no idea what they've done to the phone. You know, so I've got that as a concern. So to address that, the second approach that they have is a private cloud, a cloud which in this which case is dedicated devices, dedicated for that customer. And no one else has access to them, and the customers then have 24/7 access to those devices. The third approach is really to take their infrastructure, they call them cradles, and to install those cradles inside the client's data center to make them available. So that way the device, the cradle, everything can be inside the firewall of the customer. Depending upon the security needs and concerns of the customer, what their requirements are, I think Perfecto can address most any of them.
I have two more.
Okay.
Do you have ideas or suggestions for testing applications where the environment is isolated from the rest of the world? For example, behind a firewall?
Do we have examples of that?
Suggestions or ideas for testing applications separated from the real world. The rest of the world.
Yeah, so I mean, if I'm building or if I'm developing an app, I mean, to do that, that's where we're going to have to look at bringing the device inside the firewall, and the solution to test it is going to have to, put the device into the environment that you're expecting it to behave in. So that third solution of deployment that I described with Perfecto would be most likely the way I could see that being done. The alternative way I've seen other approaches to it is to tether the device to the phone, to tether the computer, to plug the device into the computer, and to drive the device locally. So there's a lot of different ways to solve for how to do that, And I think it's a case of looking at the requirements and the specific challenges that exist as to how to best solve that.
One more?
Sure.
Okay. Last one. Could you address any enterprise concerns for data and access?
So enterprise concerns for data and access, I think it's best summarized when we think about a public cloud versus a private cloud. Imagine the public cloud being a seat on the plane, and you leave things in your seat pocket when you get on the plane or you get into the seat. Whatever's left in the seat pocket, the applications and data that the person was riding in the plane before you is mine now. The book they left, the data they left, the phone they left, that's the same concept as being in the public cloud with these phones, right? If I don't take it with me, if I don't take it off the device, if I don't clean the device when I'm done with it, well, then I obviously might have some concerns from a security and from a data privacy perspective. So where I think the solution then goes, that most enterprises will look at this, then they'll say, no, we really want to have a private cloud of devices that are completely dedicated, walled off from anyone else. So that way there's a security barrier between these devices and anyone else, so I'm really not sharing with anyone else. I then have confidence that these devices are sitting in a protected state, and they're just as safe, as almost as safe, I think, as if they're sitting in a drawer in my test lab. These devices are sitting there, and they're available to me in a private cloud. And if I'm really worried about it, then I bring them all in-house. But I think the private cloud is probably the solution that most people will consider. So very cool. I've addressed some virtual questions from real people in the virtual world, or if they're in the cloud. I don't know. I have virtual people. But I've addressed some of those questions. How about in the audience? Any other questions? No? Well, thank you very much. I've really enjoyed the opportunity to tell the story, to talk about, you know, the perspective of mobile and how to help solve it. I'll be here the rest of the day, and my contact info is here. I'd love to have a conversation. Thank you very much, and have a great rest of the show.
All right, that wraps up this event. Thank you for joining us, and please check out the Presentation Center for other presentations and their start time. And if you would, step over to the interview panel, where we will be interviewing, actually James Lindsay will be interviewing Dorothy Graham and Eric Van Veenendaal. That's again in the interviews section of the presentation panel. Head over there and hear from some good keynote speakers. Otherwise, we'll see you at a future presentation.